Okay, so it's about time to start again. Are you back? Do we have everyone in the class? I guess so. All right.
So this afternoon, I'm going to pick up our topic on design thinking. So in the morning, we talked about three things, systems approach or system thinking and design thinking and then business synthesis, which are three aspects that we're going to cover in the KO Edge program, especially this SDM course. And in this afternoon, we are focusing on the design thinking part. And I have printed out some material for you. And then next week, when you're here on Saturday, we will give you the King file, the Japanese high-quality file. Well, to tell you the truth, we have many Vietnamese students here, and they were surprised by how nice quality that King file is. They have never seen such a neat and solid file system ever. They were so fascinated that they ordered so many to bring it back home to Vietnam. So, yes. So I love that file. And so we will give all of you one file so that you can stock all the files, all the material that we will give it out. And I have gave you couple materials. One is the Introduction to Design Thinking Process Guide, the thin one with the black title. Yes. So it's only a few pages. So who read this before you came here? It was on the, yes, thank you, on the suggested reading. Like I said, there are so many materials that is related to design thinking. You can look online. You can find books about this. But I think this is the simplest and I think to the point material, one of those good quality materials. And this is, I think, done by D-School. And then it's carefully done so that they don't mislead you to any wrong directions. So do you have a copy? I want the copy of that thing. Okay, yes. So in this process guide, I think it's much better you listening to me than reading, I think. So this tells you the five modes of design thinking. So it's empathize and define, and then ideate and prototype, and also testing, okay? And in a combination with the bootcamp bootleg, so bootcamp bootleg consists of some mindset in the very front and then some tool set in the later half. So first, maybe five pages are mindset. So I know you want to focus on the tool sets, okay? This looks fascinating. I think most of you want to take a look at this and maybe use this. However, what I think is the far most important thing in this booklet is the first five pages. This is telling you the way of thinking, way to approach how they approach the problems and how they approach the solutions. So please, if you haven't read it, please take a look at first five pages of Bootcamp Bootleg and then the whole pages of Introduction to Design Thinking Process Guide. And I think that's enough. And then please take a look at David Kelly's TED. And then if you have a chance, please read the book, The Creative Confidence. Who is starting to read the book? Great, thank you. It's a good book. It's a easy reading book. I was surprised. I was sitting on a flight to, I think it was the United States this year. And I was reading this book, and a guy who sat next to me, he was from Bolivia. He was the bank officer, bank manager or something. He talked to me and said, hey, that's a good book. So it was my first time. I have flown miles and miles, but that was my first time somebody talked to me on the plane, the complete stranger talked to me about the book that I was reading. So I was surprised. And then we discussed about the book for like a couple hours on my way to Los Angeles, I think, last year. So I think it's a widely appreciated book. Oh, you have that book. Yes, good. So, right. So if you haven't started the reading, or if you you think you know design thinking, you can probably set that aside and start rereading this material again, because it's so essential. It's so written so simply, and I think in Japanese other textbooks than speeches, I think it made it too complicated, I guess. These are so simple and easy to understand. And there's one more thing, one more material that I did not tell you about, is that there is one material called Design Thinking for Educators Tools Toolkit. It's a material published by IDEO online. I think you need to register for IDEO. I think register in IDEO homepage or website to download this. So I did not distribute this. These are all free, and these are, you can get it online just by typing into Google. But I don't think you can get this way. So you need to log in for that. But this is also really good. It's actually like it says, it is a guidebook for school teachers, and especially elementary school teachers. So it looks like this. It looks like this. And then it is even written in a simpler wording. And so I want to start the afternoon session with the quote from this reference. So this is what they, or IDEO, who invented the term or invented concept of design thinking, has defined for this toolkit. So what is design thinking? So this question has been asked so many times. I think I have asked this question so many times from students, from people outside of campus, and I think many people ask this question. So we were always looking for a good quote from IDEO, from David Kelly, from the Creative Confidence, and I think this is the best quote that we can find. So design thinking is a mindset, period. Okay? Design thinking is not a technique, it's not tool set, it's a mindset. And then what kind of mindset? There are four aspects. It's human-centered mindset. Okay? And it's collaborative. And it's optimistic and experimental. That's it. I think this is the simplest, and it really explains a lot. So I think this is all we need to know. This is all we need to know. This is the basics. And following this, I think you can understand far more than you think you can just following these four things. And it's a mindset. Because here, these are diagrams shown or written or drawn by different organizations, different experts. For example, Okuda-sensei from KMD, he is the one of the experts in design thinking in Japan. And then this is, of course, D School's very famous five modes. And then this is Hassel-Plattner Institute. So he is the one who funded the D School in Stanford. And this is IDEO's arrows, right? So people always ask us at SDM or me, which one is the truth? Which one is the most genuine design thinking? Sometimes that's the question I've been asked. I don't know. So I think these are different approaches are introduced by many different practitioners, okay? And basically, this is the mindset, and this is how they do it. So if you feel empathy on any of these approaches, then why don't you follow it? I think it's basically the mindset, and how you do it is independent from this. And then some people have shown you the way to practice this. So I cannot emphasize this enough, because so many people are mistaking, I think, the design thinking is some kind of a tool set or some kind of techniques or collection of techniques. Yes, they have introduced some techniques, but they are carefully stated that they're just only tools. It's not a part of the design thinking. So please do understand that. Please do understand that. And you can read many books as you want, and you can learn many tools as you want, but it is the mindset. It is the mindset. And so these school materials are really good, and then IDEO materials are also really good to understand and to grasp the concept. So one thing is that this is also, you need to, I guess, register to download this, but you can register for free, and you can download the file. It's a human-centered design toolkit. It's the blue one. Has a lot of photographs. So there, they focus on human-centered approach and then design techniques. And then Creative Confidence is a book that's written by David Kelly last year, and I think that's a great book to follow and understand the true and deep meaning and then the purpose of the design thinking. So I think to read this material is far more important than listening to my talking here. But I will still cover about the design thinking. So like I said, it's a mindset. It's not about approaches. It's not about tool set. Yes, of course, tool set and approaches are introduced, but it's not that important, okay? Because it depends on your context. It depends on who you are. It depends on where you want to go to, right? So it depends on what kind of situation you're in to practice this mindset. But here are some characteristics of design thinking. So I put it, what are different from how we used to do things and design thinking, okay? And again, this is not the design thinking explanation, okay? This is just, I'm pointing out some major differences between the way we used to do, or way most of us, like us meaning people who develop, product, who develop services, okay? So design thinking takes heavily of observation, ethnographical approach. So you're like being an anthropologist, sitting there, staring at people, trying to understand why they do it, what they do it, and things like this. It's a very qualitative approach. It's not a quantitative approach. It's a qualitative approach that is overlooked by many engineering approaches and statistical approaches and marketing approaches. So observation is one of the differentiation of the design thinking. And then ideation is another key aspect that design thinking thinks heavily on. So dawning group of diverse people is encouraged. So that's the ideation. And prototyping, the fail first concept, and then they learn fast and more. Do while thinking and think while doing mentality. So that's something very different from what we used to do, or what normal manufacturing or product designing or service designing domain used to do. So these are some characteristics that's often discussed. And the design thinking is not the only way to approach innovation. So this is just to show you some of the examples that resembles design thinking approach. For example, so design thinking is here. It's human-centric, collaborative, driven by experimentation. So design thinking is that. And there's SRI. It used to be a Stanford Research Institute. Now it's an independent company called SRI. So they were a branch of Stanford. I don't know I'm up until when. But they have this approach called five disciplines of innovation. Who has participated in this course? Five DOI? No one? Okay, good. Because now SRI has a branch in Japan, and you can ask them to come over and then do this course for 2 days. And it's quite fun. There will be a really interesting guy from California coming to your place and then talking, giving you many Californian jokes, and it's quite fun. So, but this is a two-day course that's given by SRI, and then they have important customer and market needs, value creation, innovation championship, champions, innovation teams, organizational alignment. These are the some topics that they cover in this five disciplines of innovation, and then it has a resemblance to design thinking, but they don't call it design thinking. They call it five disciplines of innovation. So they have a different structure or organization. They have a different way of organize how they do it. And then INDEX, Design to Improve Life. I have it here. INDEX is an NPO based in Copenhagen, Denmark. So please take a look at this. This is really important. This is really interesting that they run design contests. They award a design award to every other year, and then the key concept is designed to improve life. Okay, you can just type in INDEX and design to improve life, and you can take a look at their winners and their finalists, and it's really really interesting. So it's not ordinary design competition, but these are all designs that improved somebody's life. And then it's really interesting that they have this criteria of the design has to be in this world for at least, I guess, 2 years. So it cannot be just a new idea, but it has to exist on this planet for at least 2 years to get nominated. So it really suits with this with the definition that we discussed this morning, right? New idea, and then it's spread it around the world or spread it among the people, okay? I think maybe they didn't have this intention, but from me, I can see that they are trying to talk about the real innovation or real impact to the human life or human lives. So if you're interested, please take a look. I think they just had competition or the award last year, 2013. And then 2011, they had interesting winners as well. So you can go online and check what kind of things are nominated and won the prizes. And of course, there are so many more. And I think the design thinking has more focus now, emphasis now, but it's not the one, not the only one. Okay, it's one of them. However, now it's taking off around the world. So this is me collecting some design thinking type workplaces. So SAP in Germany, of course, they are system integrators, and they are, of course, the Hasso Plattner. He is the CEO of the SAP. And then they are engaged in design thinking approach. And this is Ziba. This is another design consulting firm in Portland, United States, Oregon, is it? No, Portland, yes. And so they are similar to design thinking approach. And then P&G, Procter & Gamble, they have design thinking team. And then CIID is a Denmark startup design consulting firm. It's called Copenhagen Institute of Interactive Design, and they are quite strong. They're new in the market. I think they're only like 6 or 7 years old, but they're new in the market, but they're really strong around Europe right now. And then so these are practitioners of design thinking and its deviations around the world. And so we have plotted, I'm pretty sure we have more plots now, okay? These are some more well-known places that you can go and talk about design thinking. There are some people, some professor or some faculty member who discusses design thinking around the world. So of course, us, KMD, and Todai, there are many more around Japan right now. And then you can go to Europe, Northern Europe, and then you can go to various places around North America. And of course, design thinking started. Who have heard design thinking before you come to this class? Okay, before you come to this class, before. Okay, about half of you, okay. For those who didn't know design thinking, it started by IDEO. IDEO is a design consulting firm in California, and they became famous for Apple's first mouse with a one button. So they were the designers. They designed the concept and in the hardware design with Apple. So that's what made them really popular or famous. And now Stanford University and IDEO is collaborating, and they're running school or organization called D School. D stands for design. And then D School is really interesting that they do not give you any credit for this, attending this school, okay? So D School is basically, it's for grad students, right? It's basically for grad students. We went to D School last, when was it? February? Yeah, I guess it was, yes. Last February, and we had a discussion with different professors, and they are trying to keep this way. So they are not giving out any credit, okay? You're a graduate student in Stanford University, maybe you're in mechanical engineering, maybe you're in medical, maybe you're in business. And so if you are in Stanford University, you can attend the D School lectures. And if you go to D School website, there are like short courses, there's long courses, and different type of courses, okay? And then it's basically run by mechanical engineering design team, or design group, is it called, I guess, yes. And then there is specific mechanical engineering people course called ME 3110 that is specifically for innovation design, and that's a D School type class. But so Stanford University and IDEO is running this D School, and then if you're a graduate student in Stanford University, you can go, but there's no credit. The interesting point is why they're doing this. So they want their graduate student to learn how to approach the complex and difficult, ill-defined problems interdisciplinary. Okay, so that's what they want their students to be able to do. So they're not there for credit. They're not there for credit. And then Barry Cutts is a professor that we've talked to. He said the goal of D School is to train these students with the design thinking approach, and they want the students to go back to their whatever they're majoring, and then utilize or apply that in that field. For example, they want their medical graduate students to come to D School and go back to medical school and apply. Okay, so they're not intended so that medical school student to quit medical school and come to D School. No. They want these students to come to D School and learn something and then bring it back to the medical school. So this is what they are intended to do. And IDEO is behind this scheme, and then IDEO provides a lot of lecturers and professors and instructors to this D School. And we have met the lady called Kelly O'Connor. I hope she's still in IDEO. I didn't see her on the list of IDEO recently, so she may have left. I don't know. She was teaching a lot of classes in D School, and I met her in IDEO Tokyo a couple months ago, but now she's off the list, so I don't know. It's, you know, up or out. It's American company, so you don't know what happens. But so IDEO provides many instructors to D School and D School grads or D School experienced mechanical engineers or medical student or psychology major student may come to IDEO as different disciplined designers. So they are actually the heart of the design thinking as of now. And this design thinking is catching up in many places, and especially the business schools. So since 2012, 2011, Harvard University started a course called Innovation Design Thinking for Innovation, I think. It is actually a course taught in Harvard Business School. And then, do you know Northwestern University? The Kellogg? Yes. The Kellogg is, compared to Harvard University MBA, Kellogg is one of the most prestigious MBA class, MBA course in the state or maybe in the world. They now have the program called MMM program, Design Thinking plus Process Thinking. This is a new program, started I think last year. You can check out their flyers. So now Northwestern University is running a course like this. So you need to think about this. You need to think about this. So design thinking is, I think you all know, it's fun, right? It's about brainstorming. It's using a lot of post-it note, and you can do it, and everyone can engage. Like even elementary school students can engage, right? But design thinking that we're talking right here is done by Stanford students, and Harvard University MBA students who are not 23 or 4 years old. There are many full-time workers and part-time workers, right? And high executives of big firms. And of course, Northwestern University has a lot of full-time workers and high officials in big firms. So they are the ones engaged in post-it notes. You see the difference? So it's not about having fun, but they're highly intelligent, they're really knowledgeable and engaged in this design thinking approach, okay? So we need to be careful that, yes, design thinking can be engaged by anybody, and you can enjoy design thinking. However, design thinking that makes a lot of difference in the world are done by these people, all right? They're highly intelligent, and they're quite talented. And also, they are willing to work interdisciplinary. So we should probably not forget about this. And here's another interesting statistics that I found on the web, that this is 100 most desirable MBA employers. So this is the survey asked to MBA students, and this is where MBA students say they'd most like to work in 2013. And so Google, yeah. McKinsey, Apple, Amazon, and Boston Consulting Group, Bain & Company, right? You agree? And ta-da, IDEO. It's really interesting. It's in between JP Morgan, Microsoft, Starbucks, there's Johnson & Johnson, there is Coca-Cola somewhere around here. So it's really interesting that how many people are interested, how many MBA students are interested in working in IDEO. Okay, so people in MBA school, they're really, really intelligent, right? I mean, if you want to get into the MBA program in Harvard, good luck. It's very tough. You have to have working experience. You have to have management experience. You have to have strong background in certain field. And then you're in, okay? And then if you want to go out, then you have to read more. You have to write a lot and talk a lot and get a good grade. So they've all done it, and they want to work for IDEO. So I think this is really, really interesting that how we see design thinking as everybody can do it thing. Instead, of course, it's like soccer, right? It's like soccer, because European top league is a soccer. The soccer that kids playing right there is a soccer. Same number of people, same ball, same rule. But we pay a lot of money to see European soccer. We don't pay for kids' soccer, right? I think design thinking is exactly the same. Because the same post-it note, actually, it's exactly the same post-it note that they use. It's a 3M. So it's exactly the same, but they produce something very different than what we do here, right? So I think we need to find out why is it. I don't have the answer, but we need to be careful. Hey, there must be some difference here, okay? And then, this is old statistics from 2013. I just found a new one on the web saying that, so I just found it that now it is ideal has moved up to, okay, there's not much difference. This is a ranking of 2014, and now they moved up to 12th place. So, yes. So this is what is happening in the job market or for an MBA student in the United States. So I think for those who were not very familiar with design thinking or IDEO, maybe you have a different perspective now. So design thinking is, yes, is always said to be simple and easy and everyone can do it, but this is the reality. And we visited Stanford University last February, and then we had a great discussion with Barry Cutts and other professors. And then we took some photos. This is a photo of a project room that it's in the second floor of the D School. It looks like this. The mobile whiteboard as a partition. And then you see a lot of post-it notes. And then you see this kind of room a lot, okay? And you see this on the end of the hallway. So this is like a door, but they have brainstormed on it. So what I wanted to say is that they do this very naturally, very naturally. They don't say, "Hey, we do design thinking, and let's this from 10 to 11:30 we do design thinking." No. They're so natural, they do it naturally. They don't say, "Hey, we do brainstorming," or "Hey, we do this and that," but they are naturally engaged in such activity. It's a practice of a mindset, okay? So even though we will teach you step by step of some techniques here, but that is only for you to learn what the pass is, what the shoot is, what the dribble is, okay? But once you're out there playing soccer, you need to think. You need to know what to do, okay? Don't wait for your coach to say, "Shoot," or "Pass," right? You don't want to play that kind of soccer. It's a contact sports, okay? So even though we will split the steps in small bits and pieces, however, you need to combine. You need to know when to use them. You need to know how to use them. And you need to know why to use them. So this is the thing that I wanted really to tell you. So from now on, we're going to do this in a workshop style. And the workshop style is basically you're in the groups, and I will tell you what to do, and you will work on it for a certain amount of time, and then you will report back. So this is how we do it, okay? But like I said, this is just to get you familiar with design thinking mindset and approaches. And then why we workshop is that we want to get you ready to conduct interdisciplinary and innovative thinking group work, okay? So that's the goal. That's the goal. And this is not only goal for those who will continue doing the project-based learning, but also everyone in this room, because I want you to be able to conduct interdisciplinary and innovative thinking group work no matter where you are, no matter where you are. And then gain experience to think outside of the box. So this will be guided workshop so that you will somehow experience to think outside of the box, hopefully, okay? And what's expected is that I expect you to be creative and aim for innovative outcome and contribute to your team with your uniqueness. So, you know, I'm not talking about how smart you are. You are unique in various ways. So I want you to contribute to your team with your uniqueness and have fun, all right? And then what is not expected is be critical. I don't want to see anyone saying, "Hey, I don't like that idea," or "I don't think that idea is feasible." I don't want to hear that. And we will leave that discussion later, okay? So when you're in design thinking mode, you don't be critical, okay? And I don't want to see you landing on feasible, easy outcome, okay? I don't want you to be landing on doable, simple, feasible outcomes, okay? I want you to expand your solution space and try that. However, I don't want to see turning off your logical part of your brain, okay? Keep that on, okay? don't be just a crazy drunk guy or lady, all right? That's not what I'm saying. That's not what I'm saying, all right? Don't be critical, but just don't turn off your logical part of your brain. That's got to be on. That's got to be on, all right? So getting drunk is not a solution to approach design thinking, all right? Okay, so the workshop context I will give you as a healthcare, okay? Pretend you are a team thinking about launching a startup business in a healthcare domain, all right? Just pretend. And team, as in a group, okay? Your team. And your scope is global and have not decided what to focus on, all right? So you're in the very early stage. And you are in the phase of developing your concept. So you're trying to talk and develop your concept of your approach to healthcare domain, all right? So nothing's decided. You're just a team of multi-discipline people, and you want to attack healthcare domain with an interdisciplinary approach, all right? And here's what to do. So divergent thinking, okay? You need to stretch, expand, explore, extend, leap, jump, discover your mind and thinking, all right? And you want to take advantage of your diversity. This is important. This is important, okay? And then convergent thinking, sometimes you summarize, abstract, organize, structuralize, distill, unpack your thoughts and ideas. So that's basically what you're doing. So I'm trying to, you know, break these big words into more familiar terms, okay? So that's what divergent thinking or convergent thinking is doing. And then work in interdisciplinary mode, and then find insight like we discussed in the morning, and then think innovatively and obtain innovative results. So this is what you are doing, all right? So that's been said, let's get started. Who has done ideation? I want to see hands. Who has done any kind of ideation? Why you guys are so shy about? Okay, good, good. Was it successful? Who has done successful ideation? Can you tell us your story of successful ideation? The lady behind Taka?
Yes, sorry, okay. Rumi?
Yes.
Okay. Rumi, can you tell me your successful ideation story?
The reason why I call it successful?
Yes.
Because we won the contest.
Yeah. Oh, okay.
That's why I thought that's very successful.
Okay.
We don't have the very much story behind it.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
How did you do?
We respect each other. Mm. We didn't know each other. Mm. We are just stranger.
Okay.
Like us. Yes. But I think most important thing is teamwork and respect each other. That's what I think.
Okay. As outcome of the respect and teamwork, you got the great idea.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, you
want
the first one.
Good, good. Taka, how about you? I saw your hand.
Yes. The design
network. Yeah.
Yeah, oh, as the design project.
Okay. Old children. So we wanted to use that very small person device as a computer. Yes, baby steps.
Yes, but it's controlled by the device. So mm-hmm. those that close the invasion.
Okay, okay. So you went out of your box and then you found a solution. So you think you had a good ideation.
Yep.
So who said you did not have successful ideation experience? Can anybody tell us about your unsuccessful or unfulfilling ideation experience? Okay. Let's go back to you. Anybody else? I saw a lot of hands. Okay. How did it go? Oh, it's about this.
Why I'm hesitating to put my hands up is like I've been finding a successful like result. Or but we all satisfied in terms of like team satisfaction or
the goal toward the goal, I feel like it's successful, but I'm not sure whether all people can feel it's successful or not. What I did is almost the same thing, like kind of design project,
mm-hmm.
and one client asked me about creating a new service,
okay.
or new model service, and I cooperate with a lot of like nationalities, like Finnish and French and Moroccan, and a lot of people, and they are so diverse.
Okay.
And then it was really hard to get into the one direction.
Mm.
And then finally, after the ideation, we feel that we came to the conclusion that everybody feels satisfied,
mm.
and also the client they asked was satisfied as well. So I feel it's successful, but it's not creating a new kind of innovation. It was not creating innovation.
Okay, but it was a good, still good
yeah,
solution,
still
right?
Still good solution for us.
Okay,
yeah.
Okay.
It was kind of.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. Thanks for sharing. And Taka, you have a failed ideation experience. Yes, please. How was it, and how do you think, why do you think it's failed, and how did it fail? Yes.
Okay, so I'm a student of SDM. I experienced a design project. Yes, I think I succeeded in the extracting some insights, great insights. But I think our team couldn't exploit it. So we could define what to make, but we failed to transform what to make to how to make. So that's the reason, that's why I think why I failed to ideate.
Okay, so your ideation partially successful.
Inside, yeah.
Okay, all right, good. So I think many of you have tried ideation, but ideation, I think, you know, I was expecting to see more hands for unsuccessful ideation, because who has done brainstorming in this room? Brainstorming. Who were really happy about the brainstorming result? See, yeah, this happens, right? So you need to have some kind of strategy to have a good brainstorming session. So I'm going to talk about that. And then what I'm going to talk about is you need to think of these things. Why do you ideate, and when do you ideate, and how do you ideate? Okay, you cannot just say, hey, let's do brainstorming and be successful. It won't work like that. So here is a small diagram that I've drawn to explain the activity of the ideation. Okay, so there are four things that's really important, I think is important. So this is the starting point of the ideation. This is what to ask. You always have a problem or a question to start your ideation, right? Like, how do we, or how might we, or what if, whatever, right? You always have that kind of question in your mindset to start ideation. And then next is you want to diverge. You want to explore the solution space. Otherwise, you will end up with a boring or conventional solution, right? So you want to diverge. That's another point you want to focus on. And then you want, sometimes the convergence works. Sometimes you want to focus or organize after you diverged. And then the fourth point is you don't look for the greatest idea or a solution, but you look for insights. Insight that will help you to move forward. So these four things are important in terms of activity perspective of ideation. Okay? So Next perspective is that solution space perspective. Okay, this is another explanation on ideation. So when you start ideating without any strategy, what you end up is that you start filling this circle, conventional solution space, right? If you are genius, if you're genius, you're not probably sitting here, but if you're genius, you're right here for the from the first time, right? You can come up with a solution that is not conventional, futsujanai idea, right away, but still it's in the solution space, okay? You're usually right in the middle here or way off here, right? Your solution is not a solution, right? Or your solution is a ordinary, boring solution that anyone can come up with, all right? But you want some around here. So what we're going to do here today is that we're going to do, we want to expand your solution space with brainstorming, and we allow these ideas that's out of the solution space. That's okay, because just we're trying to expand. And then we're going to group the ideas with affinity diagram. And of course, we're not focusing on these ones, but we try to focus on out of the box or out of the conventional solution space ideas. And we'll find insights that are outside of the conventional solution space. And then we're going to ideate furthermore with forced association majors. Okay, so this is what we're going to do. So there are two perspectives that I introduced to you. So when you ideate, you need to focus on what to ask. You cannot just randomly start your ideation, and you want to focus on are you really diverging, or are you still in the box, right? You want to explore or expand the limit, and then sometimes you need a convergence to find what to focus on, all right? And then you don't look for the ideas, but you look for good insight to move you further. So these are a very simple four things that you want to keep your head on, and then. The other way, you want to stay out of this area, right? Because you are aiming for innovative solution. So, but you still want to keep yourself within this solution space, of course, because if it's out of the solution space, it's not solving your problem. So this may communicate well to you, this may not to some of you, but this is one way or two ways to understand the ideation process. And so ideation tactics. So I've talked about the strategy. Ideation tactics could be, you need to define the context, okay? So you need to define what you're ideating for, and then you need to define the problem. You want to clarify what you're asking for, okay? Otherwise, your ideation can go anywhere, and you don't know what you're doing. And this is really, really important. You are intentionally thinking outside of the box, okay? You are intentionally doing this. You're not just randomly going out of the box, but you're intentionally doing this. You are pushing yourself, okay? This is very important. And then need to know what defines the box. Like I said, like we've been saying, you need to know where the box is, and you need to know what's inside the box, all right? Because otherwise, you don't know whether your idea is in the box or out of the box if you don't know what's in the box. It sounds like more of a riddle, but you understand that. And it's not about finding an idea, but expanding your idea option further, okay? So I cannot emphasize this enough, but that's what it is. And this is actually written in this Introduction to Design Thinking Process Guide. So if you take a careful look at... it doesn't have a page number. The ideate section. It's orange. It's in the orange hexagon. If you take a look at that, then it says in the ideation mode, where is it? Yes. It's a second sentence from the very top. What is ideate mode? Ideate is a mode of the design process in which you concentrate on idea generation. Mentally, the represents a process of going wide in terms of concept and outcomes. Okay, going wide. So you're not looking for a solution, but you are expanding your options. So that's what basically you want to do. Okay. So if you had this perception of ideation is you're looking for a solution or final solution, no. You're trying to expand. Let me emphasize this in Japanese. これあのなんか多分私もそうだったんですけど、最初にアイディア喪失って言われた時に、なんかこうアイディアを作りに行っちゃうんですよね。アイディアをすごくいいアイディアをこうわっとこう一気に作れるような気になるんですけど、そうじゃなくてここにも書いてあるように、こうアイディアを作るというよりもこうたくさんのこうなんてオプションとかポシビリティをわっ作って、その中からまた後でいいのを選べばいいなと、こういう感覚でアイディア喪失っていうのをやんないといかんですよということが、まあここには書いてあって、これは結構私も目から鱗で、あの本田技術研究所ってワイガヤってやるんですけど、ご存知ですかね。ワイガヤっていわゆる日本流ブレインストーミングみたいなやつがあるんです。まあって言うとかっこいいんですけど、ただみんなでけんけんがくがくをなんかお茶飲みながら何開発しようかって言ってるだけっていう噂もあるんですけど、あのそういうことやるんですけど、その時もやっぱりみんなこう渾身の一撃のアイデアを作りに行こうとしていた感じがあります。それは私自身もそうで、こういうあのなんですかね、DスクールのマテリアルとかDスクールの先生の授業とかを聞いて、あそうか違ったわっていうふうにこう改めて認識し直したんですけど、やってることはこうなんですかね、自分の開空間をこうたくさん探索して広げていくっていうことをやってるんだなという、この認識をですね、ほんのちょっと変えるだけで随分違います。渾身のすごいアイデアを作ってやろうではなくて、いかに自分たちが考えている思考の枠をちょっと超えたところまで広げていけるかという、こういうイメージを持ってもらうといいかなと思います。 OK, so that's been said. There are two methods. So we started from strategy, tactics. Now we're down to methods. So there are two very popular ideation methodology or method. Free association measure and forced association measure. Okay, this is pretty simple. So free association measure is represented in brainstorming or brain writing. So you actually ideate based on somebody else's idea. So that's a free association. And then forced association measure is the classic is Osborne checklist. You take one idea and then you go through this checklist and you modify this idea according to this checklist. So you get bunch of more ideas. I will show you what it looks like. Okay? And before we get into this ideation methodologies, I want to tell you why we collaborate. Collaboration benefits us. So this is a great interesting paper from Science from 2010. They found the evidence for a collective intelligence factor in the performance of human groups. Yay, right? So if you get together and do something, you get more intelligent. Isn't that a happy news? No. Are you intelligent enough so that you don't have to fall on this? So it is a general collective intelligence factor that explains a group's performance is found, okay? It's called C factor. It's correlated with the average social sensitivity of group members, okay? Are you kooky omitted person? All right? And then correlated, yeah. And then the distribution of conversation turn taking. Don't talk too much, take turns, all right? And then proportion of females in the group. Are we good? Good, we have some females. So these are factors that has a correlation to a group performance, actually. So this was found, and if you're interested, and if you're KO people, or maybe if you work for a company, you can probably have access to this science paper. You can just type it in and find the evidence of collective intelligence. So what this paper is saying that working together in a group with some kind of factors considered, you get better performance as a group. Okay? That will boost your intelligence. Maybe. That's maybe too much to say, but that's what they're basically saying. So working in group does make difference. So this is a scientific evidence, okay? And another evidence for collaborating in an interdisciplinary way, okay? This is another evidence showing that presented by Harvard Business Review in 2004, that this is how diverse your team is, okay? This is basically based on the statistics analyzed on a patent of a company in the United States. And then this is the team members' disciplines. So it's a highly diverse team, and this is low divergence team. So this is the other way around. Alignment of team members' disciplines. So if disciplines are aligned, they're less diverge. Okay, and then if alignment is low, then they're more diverge team. And then this is a value of innovation. This is basically analyzed on a patent. So what this chart shows you is that if you have a uniform discipline team, you have a better average of outputs. Your outputs has less deviation, all right? And then if you are in high diverse team, you have a lot of deviation with your outcome, so you will have crappy ideas and your average will go low. However, you may get this, okay? So, what to choose? What do you think? If you're a manager, what do you choose? Some around here? Yes, so this is it's an interesting management question, but this is the trend. This is the tendency that human likely to fall, okay? So if you're a manager, you want to sometimes bring your team like this. Sometimes you want to bring your team like this. It depends on your context. It depends on your problem. Depends on what you're tackling, right? And then if you are working design team, you want to be, of course, you are already high diverge team, right? So for you, what you need to do is you need to admit that you will have crappy ideas, okay? But you need to be careful. You want to identify these ideas. This idea doesn't look good in a glance, probably. Okay, you need to probably look for this idea, and it's surrounded by these ideas. So from me, for you as a practitioner of diverge team group work, you need to admit the crappy ideas you may get, but you need to be keen about what could be an innovative idea. Okay, you need to identify, you need to pick which one are innovative ideas. So these two things scientifically proves that collaboration does matter, and collaborating in an interdisciplinary way does matter, okay? So we will build up on this. All right, so, okay, finally, we're at the brainstorming. So brainstorming is said to be a kind of free association major. So it means it is encouraged to build on the ideas of others, okay? Free associate is, in Japanese, it's jiyū ren sōhō, okay? Jiyū ren sō, all right? So you freely associate ideas based on the others or something like that, all right? And then you should write or draw clearly and be vocal every time you place your post-it note so that others have more chance to build on your ideas. Because it's a free association, you want that to happen more often, right? And then you go for quantity. It is not sniper rifling the best solution, but more like shooting a shotgun, okay? So when you hear a term ideation, that this is me maybe 3 years ago. I was trying to shoot for the best idea ever. All the time, but that will never work. So it's more like shooting a shotgun, right? All right. And then brainstorming mode. You need to put yourself in a brainstorming mode. Welcome wild, crazy ideas, all right? And then you go for crazy ideas too. And then give every post-it note a short positive feedback so that everyone can, engaged in giving a wild, crazy ideas. So I'll explain a little bit more. So brainstorming as a free association major. So it's like you, okay? It looks like you, doesn't it? Yes? Okay, I'll be more precise, okay? This looks more like you, right? So this is you connecting brains, all right? Free association is basically connecting your brains. And it's almost like you connecting your brains with others and you ideate on that. So free association, for example, like coffee to keep you awake, then green tea to keep you awake, or energy drink to stay awake, right? So it's associated. So somebody might say coffee, then it will, it will trigger me as a green tea, and it might trigger somebody's energy drink idea. So, simple example, but this is free association. So you are not aiming for like the brightest, greatest idea and say, I gotta look smart. I want to look smart, and I'm not telling the crazy idea because I don't want to look dumb. All right? Don't get into that, you know, mentality. I think many Japanese people are likely to fall in that mentality. これあの、なんですかね、多分日本人の人は余計だと思うんですけど、なんかバカに思われたくないんですよ。皆さん賢いんですよ。皆さん賢いのでバカだと思われたくないと思ってるんですけど、それダメ、バカだと思われた方が得ですよ。そういうことではないんですが、自由連想法をやろうと思ってくださいね。ブレインストーミングをやろうと思うと、なんかちょっと、なんですかね、いいアイデアを出してすごいやつだと思われようみたいな、会社の人特にそうだと思います。そうなんですけど、結果としていいアイデアが出ればいいだけで、連想を続けてできるだけ回空間を広げて探した方が結果的にいいアイデアにたどり着くなと思ってくださいね。となので、これあのこれもですね、よく読むとそう書いてあるんですけど、なんかついついですね、脅迫概念としてすげえいいアイデアを出さなきゃいけないと思ってるんです、思ってしまってるので、連想でいいんだなと、連想でいいんだなと、で連想をやってって広げていくんだなというふうに思っていただくと、これポストイットはるかに出やすくなります。 Okay? And you want to increase the chance to build on the others, on the other idea. So verbally share your idea. Every time you put your post-it down, you present your post-it note. Okay? Verbally share. So shout it out loud. All right? Say like whatever you have it on a post-it note. And then you want to write clearly, okay? And then make it headline, so it's short and concise and easy to read. And you can draw if you're a good drawer. Well, if you're not, you can still draw, all right? Okay? So this is, you want to increase the chance so that others can build on your idea. Again, it's a free association. It's not about, we're not asking you to have a great idea at one time, one shot. No. We want you to associate or build up on others, okay? So that's what we want to increase. And then we want to go for quantity. So the key is build on other ideas, okay? Build on other ideas. So if you see one idea, you can say, oh, hey, this might work. Hey, we have that, right? So you can associate. And to have more quantity, encourage wild ideas. Crazy ideas are okay, okay? And then defer judgment and do not block the others, all right? And so, again, this is often misunderstood. Defer judgment is not saying do not judge, right? Look up on dictionary. Defer is what? なんだっけ?こう、延期?後でジャッジしなさいと。これしちゃダメよじゃないんですよね。これあのよくなんか勘違いしてあの日本語になってる時あるんですけど、これはブレインストーミングの最中にこうジャッジするんじゃなくて、後で見てジャッジすればいいでしょってことなので、ブレインストーミングしてる時はジャッジしないと。で、ブレインストーミングしてる時は他の人の邪魔しないでどんどん作ろうということなので、なんかあのブレインストーミングのアイデアを否定しちゃいけないみたいな、なんかそういうことでは全然ないですよということ。それは後でちゃんと否定していいアイデアにした方がいいでしょって話なので、これもあの、So this is, see, this is how I do bilingual thing.Okay, I hope I'm not getting you confused, but sometimes I get confused. So, please take a look at Bootcamp Bootleg, page 28. So, I am not going to cover all these materials. I'm going to just cover the basics and essentials and the mindset. So, when you read this, you understand better.Okay, so brainstorming rule, there is, says, defer judgment and no blocking, okay? And it's often misinterpreted as do not judge or do not block. No, it's not. You're taking out of context. It says during the brainstorming session, okay? During the brainstorming session, do not judge or defer judgment and then do not block. So that's a way to go for quantity.And quantity pushes up your quality. Okay, if you get more, you may have a better chance. You have better chance ending up with better idea. So that's the mentality. And then going for quantity
There is another technique. Brainstorm, you put yourself and your team in a brainstorming mode. Welcome wild, crazy ideas and give every post-it note a short positive feedback. For example, if somebody say XYZ and say, hey, that's good, that's cool, or just say, like it, okay? So this is very simple, but trust me, if you don't do this, you will probably not gonna put your third post-it note. これやんないと3枚目ぐらいにはもうなんかこの辺にこうぐちゃぐちゃってやってこうやってなります。これもですね、日本人の皆さん、くれぐれも気をつけてください。これ絶対になりますよ。これ何にも言わずにやってみてください。これやったことある人いませんか？ポストイットに書いたけど、ノートに貼って帰ったことある人いませんか？ありますよね。ありますよね、やっぱり。そう。あと、ポストイットに書いたけど、なんか、みたいな、こういうことになったことありませんかね。ありますよね。これ、っていうことにならないように、あ、いいねって、もう、あんま思ってなくても言ってあげてください。お、いいね。お、そう、面白いね。で一言でいいので言ってあげてください。そうするだけで全然違います。全然違います。You're gonna do this later on. So, to do a better brainstorming or effective brainstorming, there are only four things you need to keep in your mind. Go for quantity, okay? And then make it so easy to understand. Say it out loud because you want to enhance the free association. 自由連想法をこう最大化しようとしてるだけなので、いいアイデアを出そうとしてるわけじゃなくて、自由連想を最大化しようとしてるだけだなと思ってください。 And brainstorming mode. Welcome wild crazy ideas and give them a short positive feedback. That's enough. And build on the ideas. Build on the ideas. You will get the quantity. So these are all interrelated. These are all interrelated. All right? So, well, yeah. Okay. One more thing. Okay. Here's strategic brainstorming tips. Okay.This is what you need when you need to do in your team or group work, all right? Clarify what you are brainstorming. Duh, of course, right? But I saw many groups and people do not clarify what they're brainstorming on. They're just brainstorming. And I come to the team and say, hey, what are you brainstorming? An idea? What idea? Good ideas? Good ideas for what? Solution? What solution?I don't know. This happens a lot. This happens a lot. Okay? So clarify what you're brainstorming. Are you brainstorming for a solution? Some kind of definition of your new terminology or recognition of the, I don't know, what's sweet and what's sour? Or you can brainstorm many different things, right? You can brainstorm for a solution. You can brainstorm for like the possible stakeholder you want to talk to. So you need to clarify what you're brainstorming on.Otherwise, you will have just a bunch of random post-it notes. Having a bunch of random post-it notes is not brainstorming, okay? Brainstorming is divergent thinking, okay? Having random stuff on the board is not divergent. It's just chaos, means nothing, all right? Well, chaos means a lot of things, but yeah. Well, all right. And then you want to ask the question that is suitable for brainstorming, okay? Question that diversity might help to answer.So, for example, is it a good idea to solve, I don't know, well, some kind of equation using brainstorming? No, probably not, like mathematical equation. No, you don't tackle mathematical equation with brainstorming because diversity does not help, right? Or diverging your idea or thinking does not help to solve an equation. So you need to identify the right question.You need to identify the right question or suitable question for brainstorming, all right? And then questions that are interesting to expand the solution space. Okay, I need to be careful on this because, yes, of course, it's always interesting to expand the solution space, but what if you set up the question that has 20 exact solutions, okay? If there's no way you can expand more than that, then there is no way...there's no meaning for doing that with brainstorming. You should tackle with the logical thinking because you know that there is only 20 or limited number of solutions, right? Let me put it in Japanese. これも、この2つもすごい大事で、二次方程式をブレインストーミングで解いたことありますか？解かないですよね。意味ないんですよね、多分。それはみんなでやる意味が全然ないわけですよね。なので、ブレインストーミングした方がいい
問題っていうのと、別にしなくてもいい問題っていうのは絶対あるはずなんです。絶対あるはず。いや、やってもいいんですけど、あんま面白くないんじゃないかなと思うんですよね。なので、この辺をよく考えるといいですよと。で、もう一つ、5個しか答えがないのにブレインストーミングやっても、なんか早い者勝ちみたいな、なんか違うゲームですよね、もうそれね。そういうことじゃないわけですよね。なので、こうできるだけ自分の回空間をたくさん探索した方がいいタイプのものにブレインストーミングっていう方法を持ち込んだ方がいいということですよね。これなので何でもかんでもお箸で食べちゃダメですよってことです。スプーンの時はスプーンがいいし、フォークの時はフォークがいいしと、そういうことです。何でもかんでもブレインストーミングを食べられると思ったら大間違いですということです。なんかその説明の方が分かりにくいっていう顔をされるともうどうしようかなみたいな。日本語のリアクションが全然ないの、これあれもうどっちがいいですかって話か。So, the questions that logical or critical thinking would not provide an innovative solution. So, you need to identify, you need to distinguish that your question might be suitable for logical or critical thinking. Okay? You want to avoid that kind of question to tackle with brainstorming. All right? So, I know it's not easy. It's not easy. It requires some skills. It requires some experience. But these, you know,I think you can logically understand these criteria, right? And then good questions or suggested questions for brainstorming would be how might we questions. And then it's actually written in the bootcamp bootleg. You can refer to page 26. Page 26 introduces you to how might we question. How might we question, the bootcamp bootleg says that it is one...good type of question that you can always think of when you brainstorm. So that's one. And another way to find suitable question for brainstorming is ill-defined questions. Ill-defined question is you have mathematically less parameter or less condition, okay? So you need to define a lot of things to find out the solution, or you still need toexplore your solution space to find a solution. So these type of questions are more suitable. And of course, there are so many more criteria for this, but you need to think about, should we really do brainstorming for this question? Or is there any other approach that's maybe suitable for this? So you need to be a little bit careful on this. And of course, you need to stay in innovative thinking mode. Okay, do you still remember this? You do not want in-the-box solution as an output. And one more thing, this is really, really important. You also do not want ordinary sci-fi movie solution as output as well. Sci-fi movie, this is too slang for you. Science fiction, this is American slang for science fiction. So you do not want Doraemon idea. Maybe you want, sometimes you do, but you don't wantA Doraemon idea that's straight out of Doraemon story. That's boring. わかりますかね。これもよくあるんですけど、まあよくですね、このインアウトオブザボックスソリューションを考えようとするとですね、必ず出てくるのがドラえもんか宇宙人です。まあ、いいんですけど、なかなかそこからどうすんのっていう話にもなりかねないので、いいんですけど、そのドラえもんの話をそのまま持ってくるんじゃなくて、なんかそのエッセンスをうまく持ってくるとかですね、こうそのまんまサイエンスフィクションとか漫画の話をそのまま持ってくるんじゃなくて、みたいななんとかとかですね、その方が後で扱いやすいと思います。今までドラえもんアイディアで打ち砕かれたことがある方いらっしゃいますか？やっててドラえもん風なアイディアが出て何にもならなかったっていうアイディエーションやったことある人、ブレインストーミングやってて秘密道具的になった、最後どうなりました？結局ドラえもんがいればねっていう話になっちゃったってことですね。はい、これやってみると分かります。多分ドラえもんで朽ち果てることがよくあるんで、慣れないとですねやっちゃうんですよね。ドラえもんってだからそういう意味ではすごいんですよ。ドラえもんよく考えられていて、かなり我々のこう先にたどり着いてるんでしょうけど、そうなんです。なのでこれをちょっと気をつけるということが大事かなと思います。 So you want to stay in innovative thinking mode. So you do not want in the box solution, but you also do not want ordinary sci-fi movie solution as wellSo you need to take a balance. You need to balance yourself. All right? So for example, so this is an example I created. How might we communicate face-to-face without a common language? Okay? Let's take this as an example. And then here's my example. Like,
hand gestures, of course, and then someone might someone might build up on it and say, hey, leg or feet gestures or body gestures, and then someone else say, hey, a facial expression and dance moves and like mimicking animal motions and sounds. What about insects? And then drawing pictures and drawing diagrams like that. You see some associated ideas and some, you know, completely off-related ideas. So this is the brainstorming you're kind of expecting, okay? All right, it's spreaded or it's expanding. It's not completely expanding yet, but you know, you see it's expanding in different directions, okay? For those who want to do this in Japanese, this is another example. これ例えば、あなたが思わずついつい触っちゃったりとか、手が出ちゃった時に口にしてそうな一言ってどんなのがあるかね、なんてブレインストーミングをしてみるわけですよ。そうすると、なんかこうあれですよ、こうイメージはなんかIKEAとか行って、ふっかふかみたいな時ないですか？これ日本語のリアクションが本当厳しいですね。とか、あとなんかこう物を見て、あ、冷たそうだなみたいな、こう、あ、冷たいみたいな、こう思わず手が出ちゃった時に言ってそうなこととか、で、あとこう、あ、意外とそうでもないねみたいな時とか、あとこう、あ、生きてるみたいな、こう触る前に考えましょうってことなんですけど、あとよくこう、あれ、あ、なんでよかった、割れてないねみたいな、あ、よかったみたいな、例えばこういうこう、なんていうんですかね、なんでもないシーンのことをたくさんこうブレインストーミングしてみるなんてこともできますよねと。いいですか？なのでこんな風にこうブレインストーミングのお題をですねちょっと考えると、こういろんな方角に思考を広げていくことができますよということですね。これあの何気なく言ってることなんだけど、明示的にこう切り出していこうかなみたいなアプローチだし、こっちはどっちかっていうと、もうちょっとこの実際にどうやろうかなみたいなのをいろいろ考えてるっていう感じですし、 andThis is very, very difficult to do it in two languages or more. You probably want to focus on one language. And to do brainstorming in English is hard. Do you know why? You need to have certain vocabulary, right? If you have very little vocabulary, it's very hard to associate. It's just random words, right? You need to associate. これあの自由連想なので、英語の単語の意味がミミッキングインセクトの意味が分かんないと、あ、ミッキーマウスインセクトちょっと分かんないなみたいになっちゃうわけですよ。これ結構きついです。これ結構そういう時は絵を描くなので、 so we don't have we don't have Vietnamese student here, but he will come next week. So 遠藤 wasn't Yuki, you were in an international team for a design project, right? So who were in the team? And took the Vietnam guys and another Japanese. So two Vietnam guys, two Japanese guys, and that's it. Right, all spoke very broken English. But they had to brainstorm in this situation. So ideally, you speak very good, all of you speak good English and then do brainstorming in English. However, that's not going to happen, okay? We're talking about entrepreneur in global context, okay? Who speaks very fluent, good English? Only those who live in certain areas, okay? Many of people who live in around the globe spoke broken English, okay? I don't speak perfect English. I don't care because I can still communicate. I don't care. Pronunciation, maybe intonation, that's okay because I can still communicate. So I think the doing brainstorming in your second language is very hard, very hard, especially English, because you need to know the meanings of the term, of the words. But Japanese is simple because you can go for sounds like ringo, inko, ginko. Well, I don't know if it's association, but you know, because Japanese is more sound phonetic, right? It's more sound oriented. So I think it's easier to build up on the sound. But English, when you say apple, then you can't say bird, right? Because, well, maybe apple is eaten by bird? So you need to associate the ideas, right? You need to associate. You need to 自由連想 on the words. So sometimes it's very difficult to do in second language. So do you agree? Or who has experience of doing the brainstorming in English? Okay. Any stories? Hard? What?
Yes. How much ideas they should present.
Okay. So it didn't really expand. Yeah. Okay. All right. So
they stick to create how much ideas. So certain number they stick to.
Oh. Okay. All right. Interesting.
For me.
Okay. Interesting. Right. So you know you want to share the basic rules and of course the how many vocabularies you have. Does really matter sometimes. So maybe for those who are trying that in Japanese or English today, you can probably feel and experience how difficult that is. All right? So let's try brainstorming and then take a break. All right? So this, okay, I'm not going to give you a brainstorming topic because that's for I don't know, non-entrepreneurs. Okay? You guys are entrepreneurs. So discuss and write down clearly what you are brainstorming. You start from there, all right? So do you remember the context giving? You are thinking of healthcare business. You are still in concept development. You don't know what to explore. You have no idea, all right? Then you want to conduct brainstorming, all right? So this is me framing you into this situation, all right? And then you think, and then you discuss, and you write down what you brainstorm. And then you conduct brainstorming. All right, so this is the exercise. This is the exercise. And so, and then I want you to check yourself, did you expand the solution space? How can, and then of course, I think you will probably fail the first time. Your question is not suitable, probably. Then you want to think, how can you change your brainstorming question to improve the divergent thinking process? All right, so note it's a good habit to clearly state your brainstorming question. On the whiteboard or whiteboard sheet paper. So this is what I want you to do, okay? So come up with a good question. You are in the healthcare domain. That's only given condition. And then I want to explain about a little bit about the tools. So you have this whiteboard papers, okay? We have plenty of this, so you can just use it as you want. And then we have a bunch of post-it notes. And then we have pens. That I think you have small pens for each of you, and you have big pens, several big pens per table. So you can use that. If your pen doesn't work, please tell us, let us know. We can change your pens. Okay? Are you okay to, do you understand what to do? Okay? Come up with a good question, and then do brainstorming. I will give you a total of 20 minutes, okay? You can do whatever you want. You can think of 17 minutes and do ideation for 3 minutes or other way around, okay? All right. I know it's kind of hard because you don't have much condition, but this is more realistic. All right, good luck. You have 20 minutes. Oh, choose your language. Choose your language. Thai, Vietnamese, Chinese, whatever you want to.
あんまり<笑><笑>
Fail first. Why don't you just pick the question and do it, and fail, and then do second time. Okay, you have 20 minutes. Okay, you need to remember all the approaches. Fail first. Okay, do while thinking, think while doing. All right, go.
ありがとうございます。 ああ。 最初に書いた方がいいですね。
So, how did it go? How did it go? Good brainstorming? So-so brainstorming, so-so. Bad brainstorming. Good, okay. So I want you to focus on
what to brainstorm, okay? Maybe never, no one has explicitly told you to do this, but this is very important. It makes difference, okay? Can anybody share us like how you changed or what you thought about your question for brainstorming? Can you share what you discussed? What is your, I don't know, how did you make changes or what did you kuhu or whatever? Any findings? Yes?
We decided the theme based
okay.
on the people's experience because
mm-hmm.
if we do the brainstorming in a team, it's better to
come up with the idea based on the people's experience.
Ah.
Because it's very different from people, person to person.
Okay, okay. So you set the question so that it will relate to your experience,
yes.
personal experience. I think you guys had a same discussion, right? So prior to the second try, you had, what was the question, the first one? Okay, the foods that is good for health. That was their ideation. So their thought was, hey, we can probably Google this, right? Google can provide you a lot of answers, right? But if you come to the experience, then Google will not provide you that. Unless you have everything on your Facebook, right? Then Google will tell you. But unless you don't have that online, then yes, personal experience is always diverse, right? Good, thank you. Any other team who wants to share? Okay. How might we improve our sleeping quality? Okay,
yes.
I'm interested.
Yeah, and we start to brainstorm,
okay.
and then we are discussing. Then we found that this topic is too large to discuss.
Oh, too
and
large. Okay,
yeah.
What do you mean large?
And because we have no the target customer, so we cannot find out what's the true need of to improve this problem.
Ah, okay. Do you have an updated version of the question?
Yes.
Not yet? You do?
Yes.
Okay.
We improve it to find our target customer to old people.
Yeah, we thought about, actually we find that we really had fun at the end of the brainstorming.
Yes.
We thought about how might we improve sleep quality for study buddies.
Mm. Oh, okay. Without a partner.
Without a partner. Then those pillows and some dating ideas.
Okay. Okay. All right. So, okay, yes.
So you noticed that how might we improve sleeping quality was too big or like broad or vague, right? So this is really important. It's nice to have a question that can pitch in a lot of things, right? So if you have a what is the happiness of mankind question, right? Then you will have like 10 billion post-it notes. But is this really diverging? Or is it's for me, it's just you have big, wide scope, and it's not diverging, right? You want to diverge from a point to broad area. If you have a broad area or broad scope to begin with, you will have a bunch of post-it notes. It's not diverging. It's just you have a big field, all right? So I think I agree that you had a too broad scope. Maybe you can say, how might me improve sleeping quality? Then you can maybe have more personal experience, or maybe you have some young male and young female, maybe you see some diversity there. Or you can pretend you're like an old person, or you can maybe impersonate somebody to come up with other solutions. Or you can even say that, hey, we should brainstorm the target first. Let's target who might have a sleeping issue, like me, like, I don't know, somebody who's really busy or something like that, right? So, okay, good. Any other team who noticed anything or who found out interesting thing about brainstorming question? Okay.
first of all, we think about the question about how to make ourselves healthy in our daily lives.
Okay, how to make ourselves healthy in our daily life. Okay.
And the we have limited question, limited answers.
Mm. So less post-it notes?
Less post-it notes. Mm. So we change the question into what is the moment we felt we are healthy.
Ah.
So as a person, for me, it is very easy to come up with the answer because I can just remember, come up with the picture of the situation. Therefore, I think that a lot of answer have come out from everyone.
Okay. All right. Thank you. I think it's a trend that you see here, right? So if you make your question a little bit closer to your personal experience, it's easier to bring more post-it notes. However, don't forget, there is a big bias. Now you are making post-it notes based on your big bias, which is experience, right? So you might fall into the box, all right? Because it's your experience. You are not African-American guy who lives in Louisiana. Right, you are a Japanese male person who's 25 years old and living in Yokohama, right? So you will lose other diversity, or you will be in that domain or that field, or you will stick to that bias. So yes, it's true, it's easier to come up with more post-it notes if you ask more personalized questions. However, you are now need to be careful on to falling on your bias, which is your experience. Largest bias is experience. So do you see how small tweaking around the question changes the outcome of the brainstorming? Yes? Okay. So in this session, I did not want to practice how you do brainstorming. You all are good at brainstorming. I know that. But I want you to become good at asking the right question for brainstorming. Okay? It's of course, it works when you are doing the project work like the people like are here who are more concerned about how you approach. But this is very, very, very important if you are doing this with regular people. If you need to do brainstorming with your colleagues of your work or your classroom, they have no idea what the brainstorming is, right? They don't know D-School, they don't know design thinking. Then this question is even more important because they have no idea to diverge or anything. You need to ask the right questions so that they can follow you and diverge naturally, right? So this is really, really important. So, okay. So this is a type of lectures and exercise you do here, okay? Simple, but essential, right? And we are not going to go in details of tricky techniques and anything like that, but we will teach you, we will try to propagate you the basic concept and essentials of the mindset and technique of idea generation and convergence and divergence, things like this. All right, fun? Good. All right, let's take a break. Let's take a break until 10 after 3, and let's be back at 10 after 3. All right.